12:01 a.m. on August the 1st, 1981, MTV opened its debut broadcast with a perfectly titled Video Killed the Radio Star. Written several years earlier in 1978, Buggles co-founders Jeff Downes and Trevor Horn, along with former bandmate Bruce Woolley, saw the future of popular music and culture, writing a nostalgic and yet apathetic reaction to the technological age ahead, and wrapping this reflection in the shimmering sounds of studio technology's newest developments. Hello there, it's Warren Hewitt here. I hope you're doing marvellously well. Welcome back to another episode in the series. If you haven't already, please subscribe. If you hit the notification bell, you'll be notified when we have a new video. And if you're into production, you can go to producelikeapro.com and you can sign up for the email list and get a whole bunch of free goodies. In the late 70s, keyboardist Jeff Downes and bassist Trevor Horn met in London as both musicians were building their music careers. Horn was dating disco singer Tina Charles, Downes recalls. About 9 months after moving to London, I bumped into Trevor. He was living with Tina at the time and looking for people to play in her band. Whenever she did a tour, I'd go on the road with her. At this time, Horn was also gaining experience as a producer, working on diverse projects from punk rock groups to jingles. Downes and Horn were writing and producing jingles together when Horn met guitarist Bruce Woolley through a mutual friend. In 1977 and 78, Downes, Horn and Woolley started recording demos together, including Video Killed the Radio Star, Clean Clean and On TV. In this early demo of Video Killed the Radio Star, Tina Charles recorded the lead vocals. Downes recalls, Tina Charles sang on the original demo of Video Killed the Radio Star, made in my flat in Wimbledon Park. But when we got the record deal, we had to re-record it and change the arrangement. I wrote a different intro and middle eight, and we extended the verses. We stayed up for nights experimenting with different sounds. We wanted to cram as many ideas as we could into a pop song. My jingles career helped because you have to get everything across quickly. After the demo was recorded, Woolley got a solo record deal and would go on to record his own version with his group, The Camera Club. Woolley's version was also released in 1979, but didn't achieve the attention that the Buggles version did. Without Woolley, Downes and Horn decided to continue as a duo, now called the Buggles, pulling the inspiration for their name from both their awareness of the rising importance of electronic instruments and studio technology, and the ever-present gold standard of pop stardom, the Beatles. Downes explained, it was originally called the Bugs. The Bugs were studio insects, imaginary creatures who lived in recording studios causing havoc. Then somebody said as a joke that the Bugs would never be as big as the Beatles, so we changed it to the Buggles. Horn similarly recalled, in our heads, the Buggles were a fantasy group that had been dreamt up by a record label that had this huge computer in the basement. The demo for Video Killed the Radio Star caught the attention of Chris Blackwell at Island Records. However, Jill Sinclair of Psalm Studios beat him to signing the group. Blackwell wasn't deterred and put in a much higher offer. Sinclair, who was managing the group and would go on to marry Horn in 1980, released the Buggles from their contract and they signed with Island. Engineer Gary Langan recalled, being that Jill was going to marry Trevor, she was also looking out for his best interests. It worked out well for everyone. According to Langan, the Buggles recorded the instrumental tracks with Hugh Padgham at Townhouse Studios in West London before bringing the project back to Psalm Studios. Psalm Studios had recently installed a 40-input Trident TSM. The studio also housed two Studer A80 24-track machines, an EMT-140 echo plate, Eventide digital delay, Eventide phaser, Marshall time modulator, Kepex noise gates, Urey and Auburn EQs, Urey 1176, DB160 and UA LA2A and LA3A compressors. Of course, the use of studio technology was essential for capturing the underlying theme of the song, a nostalgic reflection on the humanity of past music in the midst of a resigned acceptance of its seemingly artificial future. Horn told The Guardian in 2018, "I'd read J.G. Ballard and had the vision of the future where record companies would have computers in the basement and manufacture artists. I'd heard Kraftwerk's The Man Machine and video was coming. You could feel things were changing." One key to the song's success is the balance between the robotic, futuristic sounds of studio technology alongside a romantic vision of the past. Layers upon layers of elements went to the song's production. Horn explained he calculated that it would take 35 people to play the song live. Still, it was getting that robotic vocal sound just right, which he credits to Downes for suggesting they make it sound like it was coming from a radio speaker. Langan recalled, for his lead vocal on video, he was looking for something different. In those days, he wasn't the world's best singer. Like a fine wine, he has improved over the years. So, to help disguise the vocal, he wanted a sort of telephone voice, and I therefore sat there for a few hours and put it through some graphics and a lot of compression. There's absolutely no dynamics left in it whatsoever by the time it had been recorded, pumped back through a Vox AC30 and then compressed and EQ'd again. Beforehand, we had tried using a bullhorn, but it was really harsh. The task was to make the vocal sound loud without cutting your head off. It still has to retain some softness to it. And it was the AC30 that really gave it that quality. He posits that he likely would have used a Shure SM57 or 58, a Sennheiser 421, or possibly a Coles 4038 ribbon. So let's check out the lead vocal.
I heard you on the wireless back in 52, lying awake intently tuning in on you. If I was young, it didn't stop you coming
really
through.
Really cool sound.
They took the credit for your second symphony, rewritten by machine on new technology. And now I understand the problems you could see.
What's interesting is if that was off tape and then going back through an amp, it's remarkable how little hiss there is. Because a sound like that, typically, you know, you've got the tape here, so you've got to go through an amp, you've got amp sound. But what is interesting about it is, you know, now we're really into impulse responses, the sounds of speakers, because we know that can hugely affect the sound. And there you are with the engineer thinking outside the box and putting a vocal back through a speaker. Another key element for Horn was getting the bass sound just right, dry and loud. Let's check out the bass sound. It's amazing how much groove is in there and how deliberate it is with those sort of downstrokes. Like, it really is playing up to that sort of mechanical, modern idea. You know, the sort of, it's groove, but trying to sound mechanical, which is pretty frickin' awesome. I think the piano gives you this, the oldie world idea, you know, the sort of retro sound with the vocal. And then there's this, all this orchestral stuff here, which is just fantastic. And that's the sort of modern element. With the really dry, almost disco drums. Dead. Yep, disco. It's amazing how everything sort of post-punk and new wave had disco elements all over it. Synths are fantastic. And of course, the backgrounds are so hooky.
Pictures came and broke your heart. And now we meet in an abandoned studio. We hear the playback and it seems so long ago. And you remember the jingles used to go. You were the first one.
Video killed the radio star. Video killed the radio star.
Everything about this is so well constructed. I remember as a little kid, the first time I ever heard this, I just felt like it was some otherworldly music. And exactly what they were trying to go for. This old-fashioned kind of radio history, I suppose, meeting this futuristic world of which video was going to take over. Which, of course, we all know to be exceptionally true. Not just MTV, but where we are now. What are we on? We're on YouTube. All of these individual elements reflect the storytelling in the lyrics. Lyrics which reflect upon the world of music making in which radio and the sonic quality of music still reigned supreme. The song begins, I heard you on my wireless back in 52. Lying awake, intent on tuning in on you. If I was young, it didn't stop you coming through. It is this brilliant cultural awareness prior to the age of the music video, but amid the rising importance of visual media in pop culture that made Video Killed the Radio Star the perfect opening fanfare for announcing MTV's arrival onto the cable television scene. Video Killed the Radio Star was released on September the 7th, 1979, a few months ahead of their debut album, The Age of Plastic, on January the 10th, 1980. By October the 20th, 1979, the song had reached number one on the UK singles chart. It would hold the top space in 16 different countries. Its North American start was a bit slower, not charting until November of 1979 and peaking in the top 40 in the US. While it eventually peaked at number 6 on the Canadian singles chart, it didn't do so until early 1980. However, on 12:01 a.m. on August the 1st, 1981, the song got a second chance at life in the US, when its music video became the first video to air on the new cable television channel. The video was written, directed, and edited by Russell Mulcahy, and captures the emergence of a new age of music with its juxtaposition of black and white footage and retro radio era props. It also notably includes a young Hans Zimmer on the keyboard and showcases female vocalists Debbie Doss and Linda Jardim, in addition to Downs and Horn. While the video had already been released in 1979 on the BBC's Top of the Pops, the choice to use it as the inaugural opening for the now iconic channel brought the song to mainstream attention. It announced the opening of a new era in music at the start of the 1980s, both sonically and with its futuristic, past-shattering video storytelling. It remains an iconic moment in popular music history, and a continual opportunity to reflect on its past. When MTV aired its 1 millionth video in 2000, what better choice than to play Video Killed the Radio Star? MTV co-founder Bob Pittman reflected, it made an aspirational statement. We didn't expect to be competitive with radio, but it was certainly a sea change kind of video. While the Buggles' existence as a performing and recording group was short-lived, Downs and Horn continued their musical work together in the 1980s as the replacements for Rick Wakeman and John Anderson in Yes, and later their group Asia. And yet, their legacy as the oracles of popular music and television's future would inscribe the Buggles' name into the very core of popular music history. Like I was saying earlier, this song, like many of the songs we talk about, are one of those songs that just stand the test of time. But more importantly, they stood out at the time. I remember watching Top of the Pops as a little kid and watching them perform as well as the video. And Trevor with those crazy glasses and just the sort of, you know, the sound of the vocal and his performance was sort of like da, 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 just kind of staring straight ahead. It was otherworldly. And it's a perfect juxtaposition. You've got the sound of this old-timey kind of piano with a vocal that sounds like it's from a radio from the 1940s with synths and a disco groove and girls' voices that also sound like they're from the 40s. It's just absolutely superb. What a statement. And as we're talking about, the video was amazing. And actually, until we did the research, I didn't know that was Hans Zimmer in it. Maybe I did know and I'd completely forgotten, but what an awesome piece of knowledge that Hans Zimmer plays the keyboards in the video for the Buggles' Video Killed the Radio Star. And I think tying that all into MTV really shows you just how important this song was, let alone the fact that Trevor Horn went on to become one of the biggest and most successful producers that ever lived. Thank you ever so much for watching. Please leave any comments and questions below. And of course, give us some suggestions on what you would like to see. What other songs do you feel like are just as important as this song? Because this is a pretty huge song. Thanks ever so much for watching. So long, farewell, auf Wiedersehen, au revoir, adios, tschüss, heidor, au revoir, adio, goodbye, das wird Daniel.